So now, that's when you have students joining STEGS, so not STEGS yet, but they get to a chance to get involved. It's super, super simple. That way, any student within Asbury can get involved and have fun and learn from those experiences. It will be announced here in the booths. This is the main area of Asbury, and that's where we see most of the events. So that's where it will be promoted.
I was going to repeat the question. So it's asking, how do you improve the underlying issue of engagement for non-CSA and STEGS students? So there's always the 20-60-20 rule. 20% will always be involved, 60% will be involved if you ask, and 20% will never get involved. What I believe, though, is that communication is a key factor in getting students involved. And I believe that there's a lack of communication right now between the students of the CSA and STEGS and the general population. Now, I believe we can overcome this is, again, through an announcement system. The CSA holds meetings, and STEGS holds meetings every month with the General Council. And as soon as that meeting is done, it's always held on the first Wednesday of each month. On the next Thursday and the next Monday, it will be required of all General Council members, students, to stand up for 2 minutes in before each of their classes and reiterate what is available to the students this following month. That way, everything can be promoted from raising awareness about Business Banquet to smaller opportunities such as volunteering as Shinerama. And that is how I believe students are going to be able to get more involved in the community.
As I mentioned before, I was first year rep last year for Asper, so I have had the opportunity to manage a group of people before, as well as work with many people on the Business Banquet Committee this year. So I do see myself as a leader, and I have the potential to be able to manage a group of 6 or plus students under my portfolio. The age thing does not bother me at all. I think that that's something that is dependent on the person, and age should have nothing to do with anything. So I believe I can manage it, I'm mature enough, I'm a leader, and I would be able to accomplish that.
All right, so I guess I just want to address the last part of that first. So managing people who are potentially older than you, honestly, I don't see how that's very much of a problem. In fact, if I had people that were way more experienced to be handling stuff like Business Banquet, where I could just kind of look at them and be able to give them their tasks that need to do, make sure they're being on time, having to accomplish most of their tasks, that takes probably a load off of my shoulders, and being able to give sort of like an advisory position to them, not really interfering with getting involved in like, here's my ideas that I want to do, we should do them, that's probably not the right way to go being about leader. So managing big event committees, obviously Business Banquet and National Business School Conference do have committees of their own as well. So even if it's just me and the two co-chairs for BB or MBSC, then it could even go to me, to the co-chairs, to the committees. And there's ideas flying around everywhere in that sort of circle. So all I would see myself doing, or not all I would see myself doing, but one of the important things I would see myself doing is being able to collect the ideas that are feasible, being able to implement them, and just having more and more involvement, more and more ideas coming out.
I guess it's going to depend on the event. Certain events will not cost any money, additional money. Other events are going to be actually implemented to raise more money. So a simple cost principle where you evaluate the cost per head and then you add up a 2% margin on each individual, and that's how the CSA will add financial power to their existing, I believe it's $3-4 million. Looking at budgets, I've worked with a budget with MBSC. CSA is quite good, and that's the position of the finance role to ensure that our cash flow is strong and that we aren't going into debt. The CSA has never really had an issue with debt. So this is it's a great question, but I believe that all 4 candidates are able to implement all their ideas in a financially feasible way. Thank you.
Okay, so I had to work with a big budget for Business Banquet. Business Banquet is such a big event. Requires substantial sponsorship. Pretty much all of my ideas don't really require more sponsorship. The STEG Olympiad would be a combination of all STEGs and CSA, so CSA kind of overlooking and helping out. So in reality, you don't need perhaps more sponsorship, but I did go out and just talk to some potential new sponsors, not as a CSA base right now, just as personal leads, just asking them what they feel like could be done better. And so I have some leads that could be potentially going into and just get them kind of thing. So again, CSA works really well with budgets. When something does go wrong, we always try to find a better way to kind of go on with it and to see what can be done better.
So I want to think that that question was mostly aimed at me, as I did name drop a lot of services that are online that do have a cost associated with them. The thing is, we don't always have to use them, or we have to look to our MCRs. And we have a great CPP, our corporate partnership program, where we get sponsorship for events. And we're always in that extremely fortunate position. We're looking at budgets, saying obviously the university is going through a little bit of cuts right now, but the CSA as a whole probably isn't too worried about it just because of the sponsorships we're able to make with companies on the outside. So for reallocating funds to incorporate these new ideas, these new services, these new events, we just have to be a matter of looking at the benefits and seeing if they outweigh the costs. So, for example, I do really see a huge benefit in getting a project management service in. And obviously, I wouldn't try to implement it as a VPO and do it as a VPO only thing. It'd probably be a matter of discussing it with a chosen executive council and see maybe should we buy a service like that, or is there any way we can replicate that in like a Google suite of apps? Because Google Doc is, I'm sure you all use it for projects in school and everything like that, is supremely useful. We could try to replicate some of those features we get in the project management software into our council user Google suite of apps.
I'd just like to focus on two things. The first one, I agree with all of the candidates here. I think that one big thing though is the MCR. So if elected, in order to bring in good sponsorship and tell all your corporate sponsors about your events, you need great MCRs. So interviewing and hiring and picking the best people for the job is how we can to allocating costs. The VPO portfolio is basically all just money spending. The conference, business banquet, and the conferences. So I think that maybe re-looking over the whole master budget and seeing how much goes to the VPO portfolio and the other ones would be a great thing to do for next year. I don't think allocating costs in different areas is the biggest problem, but I think for new events, this would need to be looked at.
Okay, so I started AMLO, the Young Mental Health Leadership Organization. Right now, we have a ton of members, and there's also executive team. I have to kind of overlook as day one events, communication, and so on and so on. Same time as the business banquet. Sonny and I had a group of 10 students who helped us out in every area of the event, with the marketing, logistics, corporate relations, IT. You never want to really step in and just be like, no, like I'm doing everything, you guys are just here to kind of be here. You always want to help them out, always want to empower them. Always just be there if they need you. When I was on the business committee a year ago, my coaches helped me out whenever I needed it. Yeah, I was the marketing IT associate, and if I needed something, I would always go to them and seek help. And that's what I want to do back. I want to be there when someone needs.
Leading council of 50 students is much like leading council of 5 or 10. It doesn't matter the number, you have to show everyone the same amount of interest and respect. I believe that an open door policy is something that the CSA has always had, and I think that's something that needs to continue. My experiences, I did run MBSC and I had a council of 12. But I also was in charge of 150 delegates for 3 days. Managing any number is important, it's a big responsibility, but I believe it comes with experience. And I have been in leadership roles ever since I was 8 years old, captaining a hockey team. And I've progressed in that way ever since I've been 8. I've been focusing on being a leader and taking charge in certain capacities and areas, and I believe that this is the next step in my...
I believe Noah said that very well. It doesn't matter how many people you've managed. It's your attitude towards things, how your leadership style is, and that will be able to influence any number of people. I am currently the executive assistant, as I said, and I do basically run the general council meetings that go on this year. So in a way, I already do manage 50 students, as in updates and feedback and everything that goes on. So that would also not be an issue, I think. Leading a council of 50 students would be a great honor. I think for that many people to be able to look up to you and to ask you for advice and help, that would be something I would look forward to.
All right, so at the beginning of my speech, I did try to explain my past and how the experience I've gained. So I've been leader, I've been with the bottom people, I've been at the very top even. So just like, you know, student relations co-chair, I was a part of that, the whole CSA council then. But I was, at the same time, we also had volunteers in the store, so I had to manage them as well. Being a part of VP Logistics for MDSC, being sort of in charge of the committee that we did have selected and being able to make sure tasks were being done, pretty much. And just as well, being on the first year committee, social co-chair, which is almost a step out of my comfort zone for that, and being able to have a few of my fellow first years come out and help me put on that social really kind of showed me. I just want to touch on how I feel a leader is. I'm not sure if you know that picture where there's a guy sitting on top of the block and there's two people pulling the block for him, and then below it is says like, here's an actual leader, and it's the leader in front pulling the block with the rest of the people. And that's where I want to say that I'm that type of leader, that I'm not going to be just sitting somewhere in the CSA office delegating duties and doing stuff like that. If stuff needs to get done, I will be out on the floor getting stuff done. That's what I believe a leader is, and doing that with 50 people, and I've been doing it for 2 years now, being with the 50 people on CSA Council over the years, is something I've had the pleasure of doing. So, thank you.
It's a great question. So, what I've looked at for implementing or increasing sponsorship is reducing the amount that each MCR has to take on in a financially and adding an additional role. Now, this is beneficial for two reasons. One, if each MCR has a smaller portfolio, they can spend more time going out and looking for new business. And two, it's adding value to the students by offering someone another position on the CSA for yourselves to build your resume. We always have so many great applicants for MCRs, and it's easy to take on in the 9th and the 10th. In addition to this, getting students to come out with offering you, if you come to a CSA event, perhaps business banquet, or if you volunteer at Chimerama, and obtaining participation points within your class by bringing back your business banquet ticket. This is going to help drive student engagement, and it's also going to reflect on sponsors will see that more students are attending events. In turn, they're going to want to add money, they're going to want to add value and buy additional tables or increase their sponsorship, because they're going to have more access to more students.
Okay, so two things. First of all, as I've said, I have leads with new sponsors. Not just a company, but rather a network of companies. So that you have, instead of going one, like, hey, can you sponsor us? Like, hey, here's the CPP, so the corporate partnership program. Here, distribute all of your networks, all your people, all your companies, all that kind of stuff. So, but aside from that, the companies that we do have now, like, we want to keep them, obviously. We add value to them, and they add value to us. Perhaps some of them just don't see the value anymore. Maybe you have to go back to them and show, like, look, this is why it's beneficial to you. This is why it's beneficial to us. It's a win-win situation. It's not just, oh, like, we'll take your money. That's not it. They get exposure to us. They get to mentor the youth that will take their spots in the future. So it's important to show them that it's not just a one-sided money grab. It's a two-way street.
So I think with Dale and Adam's contributions this year, it really added a lot of value to the places in Asper that didn't have a lot of value in it. So for first years, they implemented the CJCC, Junior CSA Junior Case Competition, because there wasn't a case competition there before yet. In their third year, they're going to be doing nothing but cases. So adding value there and having, like, there's a reason and rhyme, I want to say, to the things that Dale and Adam did. Having a mentorship program, because for those that say that they gained the most value out of their years at Asper, said that they always had that person they could go to in their fourth or sixth year, saying that they could look up to them and ask them questions, because they were able to do that. And I think, really, I had that sort of personal experience myself when I was going for my first year, second year, and I had no idea what kind of classes I needed to take. And all of a sudden, I had Chris, one of our previous director of corporate relations, and he was like, "You know what? It looks like you're having a little trouble here. I can give you help. I've been doing all this before. I'm doing all my last classes." It's just a smaller contributions like that, being able to fully develop it into events and services in the future, is how I could see Dale and Adam's contributions and my contributions just being there for the future. Thank you.
Dale and Adam did an awesome job as Vice President this year, and one reason I do know that is because I worked very closely with them. And I think sustainability happens through relationships. You have to be able to portray your message through people, and they have to be able to believe in it. And I definitely believed in everything they did this year. CJCC was an awesome start to first years. First year council was very close to my heart. I was first year rep. So being able to continue that legacy on is something that I will take from them and I will definitely pass on to the future. Increasing first year's attendance and representativeness and everything at events is so important. And that's one thing they captured and will for sure be able to be sustained. So I think, just to reiterate, building relationships and actually buying into what they believe and what I and the president can believe and accomplish is very important, and it will be able to be sustained.
Sustainability, I believe, is all about, again, it's going to go back to adding value to the students. If something that the CSA is doing isn't getting attendance, there's probably a reason for that. And so anything that's been implemented this year, like the first year case competition, did extremely well. And a lot of teams came out, and I believe it's going to grow over the next couple of years. But I do believe it is a marker to identify where students are finding value in the services offered to the CSA. Ideas that all four candidates have brought up today, I think, are all brilliant, and I think that they will all be bought into by the student body, regardless of which ones are implemented. And I think that's going to be how we sustain the CSA's reputation as a leader in this environment, by offering strong services to the students, and that's how they're going to continue to grow and be attended.
Okay, so first of all, Dale and Adam did a great job this year. I always look at them as role models. For example, Dale would walk up to me one day, every day, every month, like, "Hey, Mike, how's it going? How's business back? Any questions? Do you need me to do this, this, and this?" And I like that. I mean, that shows a great leader. Someone who's there and wants to help. I'm so glad that I had a chance to work with Adam this year. Every week, we would talk about the progress of business banking, where we're going, what we want to do, and how he can help. So of course, I'm sure myself and all the other candidates would be the same way. It would be people you can approach and ask for anything if you need it. At the same time, I don't think any of our ideas were really conflicting. Either way, like, we work together to see all of our ideas come to life and add value to all of you, the students.